She was a member of India's National Board for Wildlife and its core standing committee from 2010 to 13. She has also served on the State Board for Wildlife Uttarakhand. Her work has contributed to the creation of new protected areas in the state. Prerna's primary focus is protecting wildlife habitats and critically endangered species, and is particularly interested on the impact of development and infrastructure on natural habitats. Nabina, can you hear me? Am I audible? Prerna has not been able to join. Prerna, you can send me a request to join also. Okay, Anuranjan Jha is here. Okay, I'm audible. But Prerna, you can also send me an invite. You can also send a request to join. Okay, so I think we'll have to resume. We'll resume after a few minutes. I'll finish this live now because Prerna has not been able to. Prerna, can you see the icons below? Do you have your phone with you? Okay, to send a request to join, you see those icon. There is this icon of
the first icon.
Two people. There are two people there. The first icon, Prerna. So, Prerna's primary focus is protecting wildlife habitats and critically endangered species. And her core expertise is policy communications and advocacy. She is a yes. And okay, so Prerna, I'm adding you now. Yeah. Yeah, you are being added here.
Hello. Yes. Can you now?
Yes. Yes, I can see you.
But wait, you know, here's a problem. This is on my phone, so let me get the audio correct. Just give me a second.
I can hear you. Hello.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. I can hear you.
Yeah, so it's a little faint for me, but we'll manage.
I'll switch off this fan. I can hear you.
Yeah, just give me a second.
Yeah, you can put on your earplugs. So technology is playing pranks.
Yeah, tech has not sided with us today. I'm sorry, we'll manage somehow. Yes, let's go ahead.
Yeah, I can hear you.
I can shout
see
a
you.
Bit more.
Okay, you can't hear me?
Others can
It's
hear
a
me.
little low because the quality of my phone is not good as my computer. So you just
Oh,
have to, and I'm
okay.
somehow not able to. Yeah, okay. Wait.
Okay, Deepa.
Put on
Yeah,
your now
headphones.
it's much better. Okay.
Yeah, put.
Because the quality of my phone is not good as my computer. I'm
So
okay
just
now. I
try.
can hear you. I can hear you
Okay,
now.
I'm
Somehow not able to. Yeah. Be good now.
Yeah, now it's much better. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm
So
okay now.
good
I
to
can
see
hear
you,
you.
Prerna,
Hear you.
after such a long time.
Be good now.
Yeah. So good to see you, Prerna, after such a long time.
Yeah, I know. I think we were together in Pehelka last.
Yes.
Is the quality
So,
of the voice okay?
yeah, it's okay. I can hear you. I can hear you.
Yeah, I know. I think we were together in Pehelka last.
It's echoing. I
Is
think
the
it's
quality
echoing.
of
Okay.
the voice okay?
Yeah, it's okay. I can hear you. I can hear you.
Yeah,
Why is it echoing? Okay. For the uninitiated, Prerna Singh Bindra is very famous, but let me introduce her again.
Hardly
Prerna
famous.
has been at the forefront of the battle to conserve India's wildlife for over 15 years. She was a member of India's National Board for Wildlife and its core standing committee from 2010 to 13. She has also served on the State Board for Wildlife Uttarakhand. Her work has contributed to the creation of new protected areas in the state. Prerna's primary focus is protecting wildlife habitats and critically endangered species, and is
New protected areas in the state. Prerna's primary focus is protecting wildlife habitats and critically endangered species, and is
Okay. It's echoing. Your phone is echoing, or do you have both the laptop and the phone on?
I put the TV. No, the computer is off, but I tried it because the volume of this is really not good. I'm so sorry for this huge glitch up, but
No,
there
it's
seems to be
okay.
a problem. I'm unable to hear you properly, but we'll just continue. Just go ahead.
Okay. Don't put on two gadgets together. Otherwise,
No, I've
it
not put
starts
both the
echoing.
gadgets together. The computer's off. It's only the phone.
Okay. Now I can hear you loud and clear.
Yeah, I have a problem,
Just.
so please excuse me if I keep repeating. Can I, sorry, can you repeat
Yeah.
that? Are a little poor with technology.
Yeah, that's true. So, Prerna's core expertise is policy communications and advocacy. She is a widely published author with over 1,500 pieces on nature and wildlife in popular media. Prerna's book, The Vanishing, India's Wildlife Crisis, published by Penguin India, was released in June 2017. Her other release in the same year is When I Grow Up, I Want to Be a Tiger, a gorgeously illustrated book for children. Okay, so you have it there. You show it to us.
Yes, right here. I'm very fond of teacup.
Okay.
Little tiger
So,
cup.
she has co-edited Wild Treasures, Reflections on Natural World Heritage Sites in Asia,
What?
published by the Wildlife Institute of India in 2019.
And
And
that's
then, yeah. Okay, this
I'm
is that
advertising
book.
my books. I hope that's not an issue.
No. We want to see your books. We want to know about your books. Because we want to know why women write.
Yeah.
And, you know, interestingly, she went to college after 20 years for her master's in the University of Cambridge. So what did you do your master's in from
It
Cambridge?
was actually, it's an MPhil in conservation leadership. You see, I
Okay.
didn't have any background. My background is management, my
Okay.
educational background. So all I've learned of conservation is on the job. And
Okay.
when I
Okay.
got this opportunity, I just, you know, it just seemed incredible to be able to go to
Okay.
Cambridge and, you know, study at this
Okay.
stage in life. Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. So welcome to our show. And
Thank you. Such
so
a pleasure. Thanks.
Yeah. Did you always want to be a tiger when you grew up? When did you realize, you know, that your heart belonged to the
Oh
wilderness,
God.
you know?
You
Tell us
know,
something about your childhood. Yeah.
Oh man,
Something about your
that will
childhood.
take, well, no, actually, I wish I could be a tiger more now than I
Oh.
ever did as a child.
Okay.
It would be so incredible to live in a forest and be wild and free and be a tigress.
Okay.
But no, as a child, you know, I was very introverted. I come from a kind of a very conventional Punjabi family. And as so, you know, you were supposed to follow a kind of a conventional life. As I write here, my affinity with animals. So should I read a little para which tells you when I realized I love animals?
Sure.
So this is the first para in my book, The Vanishing, which was released in 2017. It's on India's wildlife crisis. And I'll just read out the first para, which says, my penchant for vanishing into the wilderness goes a long way back. I would have been about 8 years old when I failed to alight from the school bus at St. Anne's Convent, Jamnagar in Gujarat, causing the city police to swing into action. I didn't alight from the bus as like I was supposed to, and causing the city police to swing into action, more so as my father was the superintendent. He was the DSP of that district, the police DSP of that district. It was my mother, and they do know their children, who eventually found me well camouflaged behind the bougainvillea in the daughter's backyard of her bungalow. Her tears of relief and pent-up anger were met with an indignant, but the peahen has laid eggs, ma. I was waiting for the chicks to come out, I said. Was math, I replied, more important than this event? You know, the peahen is, chicks are about to come out. Apparently, maths was more important, though I still maintain it wasn't. But let's reserve that debate for later. I still think nature was far more important. And I think that as a child, as an 8 year old, you know, I used to read books which had animals in it. I didn't have too much exposure of the field. Though I used to go to Gir, which was about Gir National Park, where the Asiatic lions are, which was just about 2 hours from our place. I loved books. So I read Gerald Devil, My Family and Other Animals, such a hilarious read and such a glorious introduction to the wild. I read James Herriot's All Things Are Wise and Wonderful, All Creatures Great and Small. He was a veterinarian in the UK. And he writes about his life as a veterinarian. And that's how he brought each animal alive. And it was just, so reading books played a huge role in my life. I read Jane Goodall. And for me, this little child in a small town in Gujarat, in, you know, conventional Punjabi, strict family, to imagine that a woman go out to Africa and study monkeys and chimpanzees just blew me away. I never imagined anything like that would happen in my life. But it did shape me. I loved animals. I was scared also, but I loved animals. So if there was any dog that was injured, any pup that, so the kids around would get them to me. If a squirrel fell down from the bush, or if there was an injured bird, I would try and nurse it. They would all eventually die, and then I would give it a burial and I would cry. And, my mother played a huge role. She was very compassionate. It was just her compassion. She believed all of us have a right to dignity, to live and die in dignity, whether you're an animal, a bird, a human, a woman, a rich, poor, it doesn't matter. So I think all of that played a role. But as I said, I was expected to charter a very conventional life, score well in school, get a degree, hold a job, marry, and settle down as good Indian girls do. But I guess I wasn't as good as, I was wild, as you say. So I did do personnel and management. I started my career in IIM Ahmedabad. It was quite nice, actually. IIM Ahmedabad's a nice campus. There were smart young men there. And we were doing research, but I knew this wasn't me. It just, my heart was not in it. Because I saw, the trees that I used to climb, they were being cut. The place where I'd seen my first wolf, and I realized they were dogs' ancestors. They made a cement mine there, the cement factory there. Everything that I used to love was vanishing before me. And I realized, I thought I had to do something about it because nobody was talking about it. It was normal. So what if the woods have gone? So what if there's a road there? But to me, it hurt. And I was idealistic. I thought words have played a huge role in my life. They have influenced my love for animals. And I imagined, you're idealistic at that age, that you will change the world with your writing. And I joined journalism to make people care for nature, to make them aware, to kindle that curiosity, to nurture that love, to reconnect you with the natural world, to make you angry. I think that's a long answer to your short question.
When did you see the first tiger in your life?
Oh man, that's such a love. I mean, I write about it in The King and I, which was the first book I wrote in 2005. Mm-hmm. So it was in Ranthambore Tiger Reserve. And I was with this fabulous, I call him Fatji, but he was the creator of Ranthambore Tiger Reserve. Literally, he was the first field director when Project Tiger was born in 1973. And he shaped that park, Fateh Singh Rathod. And I was with him. I was so blessed to have gone into that park. He introduced me to Ranthambore and tigers. And I still remember he was a Rajput. So he had this big mustache. And suddenly, and I was like, we were going around in a jeep, and it was getting late. And I was, I was having a good time, but I hadn't seen tigers. And then suddenly his nose goes, I can smell them, he says. I said, can you smell tigers? Apparently you can, but that's another story. And we wedged our jeep into a little lane. And, I see, and he says, and he just put his hand on my arm. Shh, he says, look. And I looked, peered inside the bushes to my right. And sure enough, there was a tiger.
Okay.
And then he still, presses my arm. Shh. To my left, there's another tiger. A minute later, glorious, one tiger walks right in front of our jeep. Beautiful tigress. She was just incredible. I'm like, oh my God, I'm surrounded by three tigers, three sides of us. And then Fudgy goes like this. He points to the back. I hear something. I sense something. It's, you know, my hair stands on end. And there was a tiger at the back. We were surrounded in an open Jeep by four tigers. And I just died. I thought, and my life, as I say, was BT and after T, before tiger and after tiger. It was a mother with cubs. So the cubs were almost grown up. Mm-hmm. And she was the one behind. You see, she stationed herself such that, you know, that her cubs would not be vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they didn't let us go. It was time for us to get back. It was getting dark. And we just sat there and the tigers just sat there. We waited for some half an hour till the tigers gave us way. We didn't honk. We didn't do anything. They just left after a while. It was just... And people asked me, weren't you scared? And I'm, no. You know, I think if you go in peace in a forest, if you, tigers and wildlife knows that you're not harming them. They don't kill for, you know, they don't intention, unless you provoke them, unless you harass them, unless you attack them, unless you, they feel their cubs are being threatened. So I walk in the forest with in that faith. It is the people who scare me. Will I meet bad people in the forest or outside? So yeah, it's etched in my heart, that memory.
Okay, that's quite exciting. And you know, you literally stepped into a whole old boys club, you know. A masculine world where, you know, you have to work with forest officials, rangers, NGOs to create several protected areas in Uttarakhand. So how challenging was it? Because did your gender ever come into play? You know, you
I lost you towards the end. Did gender come into play? And what do you say after?
How challenging was it to work with foresters and rangers and
so,
forest officials?
You know, the sad bit is, Teresa, I realize for any woman who ventures not just into a new unconventional or a radically different or a nascent field, but most women in their career lives, when you tell your story of how you were you know, taken advantage or people trying to take advantage of their positions in power. You know, I was one of the people who spoke in the Me Too movement against my editor in Asian Age. And you realize that for one person who speaks up, and it took me 13 years or like 20 years to speak up because there was a set of circumstances that you fight it on, fight out a lonely battle. So it was, I realized that almost all of us, I don't speak for everyone, but I know for one person who speaks up, there are perhaps 50 who don't because of the various circumstances. So so I don't think it had so much to do with being in a, you know, going to protected areas, being in, though yes, there were times I, you know, when you are alone, in a taxi that you don't know this, but you know, as a journalist, you've gone to the most remotest and conflict ridden areas. You know what I'm talking about, you know, areas which are in Jharkhand, in the Northeast, not, I mean, and Kashmir, where, and many such areas where you just, you're just putting your faith in a driver you don't know from Adam and going into the remotest of places at the, in the oddest, in, you know, at 11 at night, 12 at night at times you meet. So yes, I've faced my share of problems. My it was in the National Board for Wildlife. I was in the standing committee, which actually is the one which take decisions. I was the only woman till we had a woman minister towards the end of my tenure. And I realized that I wasn't being taken seriously. And as much as I won respect from a lot of my colleagues, as well as those in the ministry equally. There was an attitude of, you know, there's the whole old boys club, which I couldn't crack. I come also with the add-on, if you say so, of being single. And therefore, there is an attitude that goes with that as well. I think I had to work twice as hard, and I did. I did feel, yes, that I was being singled out, being maligned. But, you know, that's course of the deal. And I think my work speaks for itself. I didn't need to prove anything to anybody. I was there to do a job. And if I may say so, I think I did it well. I'm my conscience knows I did my best.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if you have a problem that I am a woman, that's your problem, not mine.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
we do our job and whatever it takes.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's one reason why I call my book Bulletproof.
Why you call?
My book, Bulletproof, yeah, because we are bulletproof.
Totally. I love that.
Because someone had asked me, you know, do you wear a bulletproof jacket when you go reporting? So that was that question actually, you know, provoked me to write this book. And
intelligent and such a correct thing to say. You wear that mask and that bulletproof vest all the time.
So I've never seen a bulletproof jacket in my whole life. So
have I ever seen
No, I've never seen a bulletproof jacket for a journalist in my whole life.
Those are the invisible jackets we wear to shield ourselves, right?
Yeah, that's true. So in many ways, I was bulletproof. So why did you take to writing? You know, tell us something more about your books and how some of those books could influence policymakers. Hello?
So I don't know how my first book happened. It just happened. I had some articles. I put them together. I just poured my heart into it. I was lucky to get people like Bikram Grewal and Sanjuri and, you know, a lot of people to help me sort of shape that book. I had great fun doing it. So it was a long time back. The second book I did, I don't have it with me right now. I've run out of copies. And it's called Voices in the Wilderness. It's something I edited, which was on writings on contemporary wildlife. So contemporary wildlife writings, it's an anthology from various writings on wildlife. My most recent books are what I'll speak about, but also before I go into the books, I did a lot of writing in media. And you know, when I started, I still remember my first job. My first job was with Sanctuary, which is a wildlife magazine. First job besides the IM one. But I thought Sanctuary was read by people who were already interested in nature. I had this again, that idealistic notion in me that I want people who are not initiated, who don't, when I used to look at the newspaper, there was sports, there was politics, there was, the international affairs, there was everything, but there was nothing on things that I felt mattered, on water, on environment, on it touches each one of us, on nature, on deforestation. It's a natural heritage. Why were we not? So I walked into this, I thought I'll join a newspaper. I won't go into the whole story of how I was ridiculed for actually wanting a job and want to write on wildlife and conservation and environment. So
you
I was given a job.
By whom?
By the editor of the newspaper. The words were, if the zoo, for there to click a picture of the cubs, and that's all that we spend on environment. I said, okay, what do you need? What do you need a person for? Movies and to make pages. I said, okay, I'll do that as long as you let me write on environment. So my day job, as I call it, was to bring out a magazine of supplement on movies. And I did the entire gamut of interviewing Shah Rukh Khan and, you know, those times and Hrithik Roshan and designing movie pages. It was fun, I won't say that, but it irked me that we recognized, Bollywood was this, but environment was not given space, given no investment. And I don't just mean money, but editorial thought, in time investment, energy investment. And so I worked my night job, which was to find, dig out stories, build my contacts in forest department. And I was just a greenie, just a kid out from having gone through a personal crisis from Ahmedabad to this big back town of Bombay and then Delhi. I had no contacts at all. But, any one day free I would get, I would run to the forests, go to Sanjay Gandhi National Park, take a train to Nagpur at night, go to the meet the chief wildlife wardens there, whatever it took. And slowly I started doing stories and they reached page one. And what, ultimately the competing newspaper had to keep an environment reporter. And I felt, that was when I felt, yes, because this was doing. So, that gave me a lot of satisfaction that I am covering things which matter to me. I have never been given a job as an environment editor, reporter in my entire life. I've always covered it with my time, my money, and I've never grudged it at all. I would do it 100 times over because but yeah, my books. So I didn't write for a long time after 2010. I have this, the biggest regret, and there are many others, but professionally, is that I never do a diary. I've been to amazing places. I've been to Pakistan. I've been to places in Jharkhand and remotest, most beautiful parts of India, met incredible people. And by now, I was also, I had a lot of, let's say, experience and also an insider's view of the horrors that are happening on our environment front, especially conservation. And I wanted to pen that down. And that is what The Vanishing is all about. It's about India's wildlife crisis. It's an unspoken crisis, because people say, hey, tiger numbers have increased. So what are you worried about? But that's not the story. I tell the real tiger story here, and wildlife is being decimated. We are losing. We have no political will to conserve it. We are diluting laws that conserve wildlife. We are slaughtering forests. We are clearing forests, and a forest gone, a species gone, is gone forever. We have critically endangered species, of which lower than 100 birds remain. What are we doing? If we lose, this is where our water comes from. We know we are seeing COVID, right? Where did COVID come from? It's one microbe which has brought us to our knees. Why did that microbe come? Because of deforestation, which has pushed us into proximity with wildlife. In normal situations, these microbes lie dormant. It is because of the illegal trade of wildlife. We can't play around with nature. Nature has to be our ally. It's not just about saving elephants. We need nature. Nature does not need us. So, it was, and
True.
but the book does is not only about the crisis. It's not only about the problems that wildlife has, the problems of governance, the problems of critically endangered species, of loss of habitat, of fragmentation of habitat, how we must factor in environment in development. It's also about the nature of animals. It tells you how leopards, recognize their own. They might meet after 2 years, a brother and sister, but they'll recognize each other. How
Wow, really?
elephants care for each other. They
Wow.
it talks about these men who follow these elephants and save them from conflict situations, and how the elephants respond to these people. How elephants care for their children.
Wow.
How they are a family. They are such wise, intelligent creatures. If you start me on elephants, we'll be talking for the next 2 hours. Because it's watching elephants is. I've got incredible stories on elephants, but they are very wise. They are intelligent. They are social. They have families like aunts and grandmothers. They are matriarchs who lead the family. They impart their wisdom. The kids are brats, and they are not brats, but those lovable, naughty brats who love to. It's and how they protect their children. It's and what are we doing to them? You know, killed by and many of these railway accidents. It's when the mothers and the aunts go to save the young, that is when you'll see seven die. You know, why did seven die in a railway accident? Because they go to save their own. So I nature of animals because I want people to care about them. It's only when people care. It's, you know, conservation is from the heart. It's it has to be based on knowledge, but it's from the heart. So that's yes. And of course,
We have a Sorry. We have a comment from Mr. Bantelang Singh Rumnong. He's from Meghalaya, if I'm not mistaken. He says environment.
Has retained its wildlife because we have tigers, we have elephants, we have leopards, we have carnivores in the second most populous country in the world, right? While many Western countries, which we otherwise say, wow, look at US, you look at UK, they have wiped out their predators. They used to have wolves, they're gone. Why? One is good laws, which we had and which we are diluting right now. The other is because of a tolerance, because of the fact that we accept wild elephants and tigers as neighbors. It's amazing. You'll see horror stories of leopards being beaten to death. What you don't hear is how they coexist, how a leopard is saved from, you know, when it falls into a well. It is so community, it is because of the resilience, the acceptance, the courage, and the amazing people that we are, that we accept losses. Not just of, you know, elephants coming in and your field, you know, they are overnight, your crops are gone. But the people will not say kill the elephants. They'll say inko kahin le jao. So I think the support of communities is critical. It is critical to save our wildlife. They need to also be appreciated, compensated for their losses. They need to be involved in conservation at the same time. We need to also recognize that, you know, the pressure of communities, but more so, I'm not discounting the development pressures. That's much more than communities. But the fact that the forests are shrinking, the wildlife are shrinking, and, you know, people depend on these forests. They are encroaching into forests. There is a huge pressure on forests because of fuel wood, because of fodder. And that is what increases conflict because they go into wildlife areas. So these are issues we need to resolve because we have to take the social context into conservation. You know, the wildlife will handle itself, but we need to fulfill these social issues. We need to address these issues. So it's conservation is not about wildlife, it's about people.
So Dimpi Mahanta says, people can't accept the reality and whoever questions the status quo is targeted. That's a hard reality now. Yes.
You want me to comment on this?
Well,
no. I mean, we know that to our cost, we question, but we can't stop questioning the status quo, right? I mean, if you... So we've been called anti-development, we've been called anti-national, we've been, you know, it's not easy to question the policies of governments. It's not easy to say that we don't, this dam is going to destroy thousands of hectares of virgin rainforests, which has critically endangered species, which has tigers, which has pandas, red pandas, which has natural sites. It is, and people are bearing the cost. People are being targeted. Environmentalists are being killed. People who report on environmentalists, so it's supposed to be the new frontier of war reporting. Forest staff is being killed. Our rangers are being killed. We have India has the highest mortality. I broke that story. The highest mortality of forest frontline staff. That is guards, tiger trackers, forest rangers in the world. They are being killed by miners when they stop stone mining, sand mining, poachers. You know, this is something that's happening every day. We are being targeted, but that doesn't mean, and you know, it is our natural heritage. It doesn't belong to the government. It belongs to everybody, and it belongs to nobody. It's therefore it needs to be conserved for posterity. And if you cow down or if you give up hope, then you have lost the battle. So I don't think, you know, that's I mean, we have right-wing governments in most countries. We have you know, it's the onslaught on environment, whether it be on in India or in the US or, you know, Brazil, Australia. We're all facing the same situation and all of us are fighting. But, you know, we need people. We need more people on board. We need more people to speak out. The governments need to know that people care. If people don't care that their children are breathing toxic air, you know, we have lost the battle. But unless governments know that it's a democracy, right? So unless people show governments that they care about that the tiger remains, that we need fresh, clear air, governments are not going to do anything.
So Mr. Rumnong says we have to coexist. Okay, that's the, you know, ultimate truth. But Prerna, can you tell me how can you make children develop a love for nature, environment, and the wildlife? How can we start young?
See, children are born wild, right? When a child is born, it's born wild, like all animals. We are animals. And then we school them, right? And then we school them and we untame them. We tame them into being. So I think, you know, let the child run. So what if it's playing in the mud? We survived. You know, closeting a child, we have to nurture their curiosity. We have to, I learned by reading. I imbibe that curiosity, that love for nature by reading. Give them books. Now you have nature walks. Introduce them to birds and flowers and butterflies and bees and dragonflies. I mean, just the little things around in your home. Do we know dragonflies fly from here to Africa? Those little things with those incredible glassy wings. They migrate like over 10,000 kilometers, man. How incredible is that? So I think, you know, exposing your child and not closeting them. अरे मेरा बच्चा बाहर नहीं जाएगा, अरे मड में नहीं खेलेगा. यू नो, इन आवर कॉलोनी व्हेन दे सी अ बी हाइव, दे पोर पेस्टिसाइड्स ओवर इट. आई मीन, इट्स नॉट जस्ट माय कॉलोनी, देयर आर मेनी सच कॉलोनीज. अरे एक बार काट लिया, कोई बात नहीं. आई मीन, यू नो, एंड व्हाट एन आर्किटेक्चर मार्वल दैट हाइव इज. टेल योर चिल्ड्रन अबाउट दैट.
वाओ,
यू नो, टेल यू द वे बीज वर्क. यू हैव लर्नड सो मच फ्रॉम बीज. सो kindle curiosity, encourage curiosity, get their hands dirty. You get your hands dirty. And you, I mean, yes, I would say take them to nature parks, reserves, etc. But not child, yeah. He's a young adult now. Aman, if you follow him on Twitter, Aman Sharma, he from his bathroom window, I don't know, I want to hang around his bathroom because he sends the most incredible photographs of birds. So there are, I think, so much one can do. When I speak about this, children ask me all the time, what can we do? And, you know, but we have to retain that interest. They are bombarded with so many things these days. And in this, I speak a bit about it. I mean, and, you know, there are many ways their interest can be retained. And they have this innate curiosity, innate love for, let them be wild. In short three words.
So we are running out of time. So if we have any questions, we'll take some questions. And Prerna, which is your favorite forest?
No, that's like asking me which is my favorite. But like
Oh.
the minute I say that, oh my God, the Corbett landscape and your Assam, oh,
Okay.
Manas is to die for, you know, so very difficult. Western Ghats, the Sal forests in Kanha, Odisha, and the beach where the turtles nest, they're all beautiful. So no, and incredible memories attached to them. They, you know, so I think all forests are treasures. And you might have gone to one 20, hundreds of times. I've not been so fortunate, but you'll always learn. You'll always. Somebody said that, you know, you're targeted every. It's all worth it, man.
So I think it was a lovely conversation. We learned so much from you, and we hope to catch hold of your books. And I'm going to buy this book for my daughters. When I
Oh,
grow up,
wow.
I want to be a child. I want to be a tiger.
I would love to meet your
So
little cub, Teresa.
the two of
But
them.
thanks so much for inviting me. I'm sorry for the initial problems, but
No,
it
that's
was,
fine.
I mean, talking with you, somebody whose story I would like to listen to at, you know, after reading your book. So thank you for calling me on this show. It's my privilege to be here and my pleasure.
So, good night, everyone. And you can access this video on my YouTube channel. Do subscribe to my YouTube channel. After the show is over, we'll put it up. Good night, everyone. Thank you so
Good
much.
night, everybody. Thank you.
Good night.